It is a chronic disease of the liver that often occurs in conjunction with chronic inflammatory bowel disease. It is rare and complex, so specialized expertise is required in order to manage it.
Primary sclerosing cholangitis, or PSC, is a rare disease of the bile ducts leading to inflammation, fibrosis, and scarring. It is of presumed autoimmune origin, but the pathogenesis is not understood, and to date, we still do not have an effective treatment for this rare disease.
In Europe, the prevalence of primary sclerosing cholangitis is 10 in 100,000 people. The disease can start at any age with a peak incidence between the ages of 30 and 40. More than 60% of PSC patients are male.
PSC belongs to the group of autoimmune liver diseases, and it is assumed that there is a dysregulated immune response at the mucosal surface of the bile ducts, maybe in contact and as a consequence of contact of immune cells with commensal bacteria within the biliary system, similar to the pathogenesis of inflammatory bowel disease.
There is a strong association of PSC with inflammatory bowel disease. It occurs in 60 to 80% of cases. 2.4 to 7.5% of patients with ulcerative colitis and 1.2 to 3.4% of patients with Crohn's disease develop PSC.
In most patients, PSC is a chronic and progressive disease, which leads to liver cirrhosis, liver transplantation, or death within 10 to 20 years of time. One of the most dreadful complications of this disease is the development of hepatobiliary cancer, which develops at a risk of around 10 to 20% lifetime risk for every patient.
Typically, the patients are asymptomatic in the early stages. Complications can arise in later stages, once the bile ducts have developed strictures. Distinct strictures leading to obstruction of bile flow may cause pruritus, jaundice, abdominal pain or fatigue, which can lead to the diagnosis of this disease. This is a typical course of PSC. The female patient, now 44 years old, was diagnosed with ulcerative colitis at the age of 23. This was followed 4 years later by the diagnosis of PSC. Since then, stenosis of the bile ducts have been dilated several times interventionally. Recently, and as a rather infrequent presentation, high transaminase and IgG serum levels occurred, which are not typical of classical PSC.
The patient has, over the course of almost 20 years, developed beginning liver cirrhosis. That is typical for PSC. However, in her case, we also had a very pronounced elevation of transaminase levels and also immunoglobulin G, IgG. That prompted us to recommend performing a liver biopsy in order to exclude additional signs of autoimmune hepatitis. And indeed, in her, we could confirm a high-grade inflammatory activity which required the intensified immunosuppressive treatment she is now receiving.
In most patients with PSC, the laboratory shows an elevation of cholestatic liver enzymes. But in about 20 to 30% of patients, alkaline phosphatase levels remain normal. The transaminases are usually only slightly elevated in PSC. While autoantibodies are frequently present, they do not confirm the diagnosis.
We often have elevated autoantibodies such as ANA or ANCA. However, none of these is disease-specific. Today, we know that some of these antibodies are associated with the course of disease, especially PR3 ANCA and the novel anti-GP2 antibodies.
Cholangiography is crucial to diagnose PSC. Nowadays, this is usually performed as magnetic resonance cholangiopancreatography, abbreviated MRCP. This shows typical changes in the bile ducts with strictures and dilatations, which define the diagnosis when other causes have been excluded.
For the evaluation of a patient with PSC, it is of great importance to receive a high-quality MRCP scan. And if you do not receive a high-quality scan, please repeat the scan or send the patient to a center experienced in performing high-quality 3D reconstructed MRCPs. Abdominal ultrasound is part of the diagnostic workup of a patient with PSC. And we look at the spleen size as a predictor of disease progression. We look at the liver and the bile ducts, and also at the gallbladder, because the gallbladder harbors a risk to develop polyps, and these polyps can become gallbladder cancer and should be either surveyed or a finding of a polyp should lead to cholecystectomy.
Because of the strong association with inflammatory bowel disease, colonoscopy is indicated in the diagnosis of PSC, even when IBD was not present.
The inflammatory bowel disease associated with PSC has a specific phenotype. It usually presents as a mild pancolitis with a right-sided predominance, and that is why many patients do not present with any complaints of this disease. And the complications that may develop, including dysplasia and carcinoma, are often found in the right side of the colon.
Even if the colonic mucosa is macroscopically unremarkable, biopsies and their histological examination may demonstrate inactive IBD. An unremarkable colonoscopy should be checked again after 3 to 5 years. If there is a finding, annual colonoscopies are recommended for surveillance. This has been shown to improve survival in colorectal cancer malignancy.
In patients with classical PSC, a liver histology is not required to diagnose the disease. However, a specific benign variant of PSC, the so-called small duct PSC, can only be diagnosed with a typical liver histology. In these patients, the cholangiogram is normal. In some patients, around 5 to 10% of all cases, we see additional signs of autoimmune hepatitis, as in our patient. And this we can only for sure diagnose with a liver histology. Other forms of secondary sclerosing cholangitis have to be considered in the differential diagnosis of a patient with PSC. The most important being IgG4-related cholangitis, or IAC, which often presents together with autoimmune pancreatitis, and secondary sclerosing cholangitis induced by recurrent stones in the biliary system and localized strictures induced by either cholangiocarcinoma or pancreatic carcinoma in case of distal bile duct strictures.
There is currently no evidence-based medical treatment for PSC that delays disease progression. Many experts recommend ursodeoxycholic acid as with primary biliary cholangitis. This is thought to delay disease progression in early stages. However, it is only licensed in a few countries to treat PSC.
From the pediatric field, the use of antibiotics, mainly vancomycin, has been propagated. However, most recent data show that also in children with PSC, the use of vancomycin may not alter the progressive nature of this disease. So we do not recommend on a regular basis using oral antibiotics for PSC itself. However, having said that, acute episodes of bacterial cholangitis need urgent antibacterial treatment, and this may develop into a medical urgency and may require hospital admission and endoscopic intervention.
Endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography may be indicated in acute situations with obstructive cholestasis. It has the advantage of interventions such as biopsy, dilatation, or stenting during the diagnostic procedure.
PSC is a complex disease, and the decision on when and how to perform endoscopic intervention is not easy. It is therefore highly recommended that the patient will be discussed in a multidisciplinary team experienced in the treatment of these patients before starting endoscopic interventions. Liver transplantation is the only treatment with a proven benefit on patient survival. Therefore, a patient with PSC should be presented to a transplant center once the bilirubin cannot be reduced below 3 to 5 mg per deciliter anymore. Liver transplantation has an excellent outcome in PSC, with a 5-year survival rate of above 80 to 85%. The disease PSC represents one of the major challenges in hepatology, one of the few diseases without an effective medical treatment option. Therefore, I believe it is of great importance to involve an experienced center early on in the treatment of these patients. We should try to include patients into clinical trials evaluating novel treatment options. And if in doubt, you can contact experienced centers also within the European Reference Network for Hepatological Diseases to get a proper patient consultation and treatment recommendation.